Heaven must be a beautiful place. Heaven must be a beautiful place. Heaven must be a beautiful place. It's filled with nothing but my Jesus grace. Well, I'm on my way home. Don't you want to go? I'm on my way home. Don't you want to go? I'm on my way home. Don't you want to go? Well, I've got a home on the other shore. Heaven must be a beautiful place. Heaven must be a beautiful place. Heaven must be a beautiful place. It's filled with nothing but my Jesus grace. Well, I've come too far, turn back now. I've come too far to turn back now. I've come too far to turn back now. Well, Jesus said I'll help you make it home somehow. Heaven must be a beautiful place. Heaven must be a beautiful place. Heaven must be a beautiful place. It's filled with nothing but my Jesus grace. It's filled with nothing but my Jesus grace. Lay that weight upon the Lord, shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as an eagle. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall walk and not faint. Teach me, Lord, teach me, Lord, to wait. They that Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He lead me beside the still water. He restoreth my soul, and he maketh me whole. Lead me, Lord, lead me, Lord, all the way. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as an eagle. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall walk and not faint. Teach me, Lord, Teach me, Lord, to wait. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He leads me beside the still water. He restoreth my soul, and he maketh me whole. Lead me, Lord, lead me, Lord, all the way.
Good evening. What an amazing thing to be able to say is the Lord is my shepherd and I shall not want. That's amazing. I'm not going to take up any of Derrick's time. He's going to come preach for us tonight, but do remember Paige and Betty. I went and saw Paige yesterday. He wasn't doing good. I went and saw him this evening. He was doing better. So he's, if one word describes him, he's resilient. But he's probably on short time, and he needs our prayers. We sure would and will miss Paige one of these days, but if you get a chance, call them. Whatever you feel like you ought to do, if you feel like you need to do something, you better do it soon. Amen. Appreciate you coming out tonight. I know it's not easy to come on these nasty, foggy nights. I was thinking earlier, I thought, well, half of them won't be here because it's so foggy, and it's like the Lord said, well, half of them will, though. So, amen. Come on, brother. Mind the Lord.
Good evening. I'm green, I guess that's good. Good to see each one of you this evening. Thank the Lord for allowing us to be in his house. We missed being with you Sunday morning. Got a call later in the week and asked if we'd come fill in for Brother Phil Arnold. And so we got to go over there and preach for him Sunday morning. Had a great time and had a good time in the Lord. But did miss being with you. I did. I really did. And I thank the Lord for all that he does for us and all that he's going to do. Wednesday night before last, I guess. When did you ask me to preach? Last Wednesday night? Last Wednesday night then. Wednesday night before last. One of them Wednesday nights, you asked me if I would stand in tonight. And we were sitting right there. And within 5 minutes, the Lord laid something on my heart. And I thank the Lord for that, for making it easy for us sometimes. He knows exactly what we stand in need of, and I also try to be just as quick as possible, but an hour, hour and a half, we'll have it covered, and then... hey, man, you're going to appreciate your pastor by the time we get done. Now, if you have your Bibles with you tonight, let's look in the book of Mark. Chapter number 4. And even though you can have something on your heart for a week, 2 weeks, sometimes you're still unsettled. And just exactly what God, What do you want out of this? What do you want us to do? And been that way all afternoon, and every night that I get ready, I've got Pandora on my phone, and everybody knows Calvary Reflections. Well, they've got their own station on Pandora, and I just flip my phone on, and I just listen to music all afternoon, and man, the Lord just helped us this evening in trying to figure out what God would have us to do. Let's stand in honor reading of God's Word, if you can and will. And Mark chapter number 4 and verse number 35, find your place, say amen. Amen. The Bible says in verse number 35, "And the same day when the evening was come, he saith unto them, Let us pass over unto the other side. And when they had sent away the multitudes, and took him even as he was in the ship, and there were also with him other little ships, there arose a great storm, and the wind and the waves beat against the ship, so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow, and they awake him. They say unto him, Master, carest not that we perish? And he arose, rebuked the wind, said unto the sea, Peace be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? And they feared exceedingly, and said one to another, What manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him? Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, again, we come to you as humble as we know how. Lord, we just want to thank you for this Wednesday night. Lord, we thank you for each one that's made their way out tonight. And Lord, I thank you for this church. Thank you for the pastor. Lord, I thank you, Lord, for giving us a place to come and to worship you. And Lord, I pray that you'll just pour your spirit out upon us tonight. Lord, I pray that you would use us for your honor and glory. Lord, I pray that you'd help us open up our hearts. And Lord, just take the word tonight and apply it to our lives. Lord, I pray you challenge us, you encourage us, you strengthen us. God, give us what we stand in need of tonight. Lord, you know our heart better than we even know it ourselves. And Lord, I just pray, have your will and way. Thank you so much for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You may be seated. That may be a very familiar passage of Scripture to you. And as we look at this Scripture, we kind of get an idea of where we are here. Is that if you go back into chapter number 3, and it talks about a multitude of people that's just been healed. People that had evil spirits, that they would even, as they come in contact with Jesus, they'd bow down before him because they knew that there was the presence of God there, and that evil couldn't be a part or couldn't stand out against that. But there was a man with a withered hand was healed. But what really stuck with me was multitudes. Not just a handful. I mean, you know, we've got quite a good crowd here tonight, but there's room for many more. But you think about at this time when all these people come together and they come to hear and to see what was going on with Jesus, there was the place was packed out. I mean, there was no room for anybody else around. And everybody that could, they'd come in contact with him, whether they held out a withered hand or they pointed him out. And I don't know about you, but if you ever get around somebody, and especially a group of people, and they all want to share with you their problem, sometimes that's exhausting. It really is. And so that's what was taking place here. Everybody that come in contact with Jesus, they wasn't coming to worship. They wasn't coming to magnify him. They came because they had heard that he would heal them, he would touch them. And somebody walked back by and said, man, you ought to see what that man just done for me. And they'll run over there and they'll start to share their problem. And they said, and he did it for them. And then they go do it. So multitudes of people had just been healed. And we get over this scripture here that he's picked out his 12. He's poured out some parables, and no doubt, I'm telling you, he has really done some work in the last 24 hours. And it says that in the same day, in the evening, was come that he saith unto them, let us go over to the other side. What Jesus was really doing right here is exhausted. He's about had all he can take. Now, we got to remember, this is God in the flesh. He felt pain. the same way we felt pain. He got hungry the same way we get hungry. He went through everything that we deal with on a daily basis if he didn't sin. So he's exhausted. I mean, everybody's mentally, physically, everything about him, he's just exhausted. He says, we got to get out of here. More or less what he's saying. We've got to go. So he tells his disciples, he said, let's go to the other side. Other places in Scripture, he says the same thing. He said, let us go to the other side. It's a commandment. He's told his disciples what he wanted them to do, and it's up to them to do what he's asked. He says, let us pass over to the other side. And when they had sent away the multitudes, notice they took over right here. They seen how exhausted he was. They took over here, and they've sent the multitudes away. And it says, when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship. Now you can try to get you a commentary out and find out something about this, and there's no deep discussion about even as he was, but even as he was, as I believe that they had to help him in the ship. I believe that the disciples went over, and maybe one on one side and one on the other, and they heaved him up, and no strength left in him, they take him over and put him in the boat. I believe, now we'll find out, this scripture says that he was in the hinder part of the ship asleep on a pillow. Now, I believe that the disciples were so amazed at what they've just seen. They seen how exhausted that he must be. They had compassion on him. So they've come and they've put their arms around him. They picked him up. I believe they took him to the hinder part of the ship. I don't believe he was carrying a pillow. I believe probably the disciples, one of them, probably made a pillow out of their cloak or something along those lines, and they put it under his head, and they laid him down there, and they said, you just need to rest for a little while. He said, go to the other side. So the disciples put him in the boat. They allow him to rest, and what do? They head out toward the other side, just like he said for them to do. I wonder, Eric, though, when they started going toward the other side, if they wasn't reminiscing. They probably didn't get far off, and Jesus is asleep, and they're looking back at him, and they're grinning from ear to ear. Saying, this is our Jesus. We're in the boat with the one we just seen healed the withered hand. He's poured out all these parables, and when we were by ourselves with him, he explains all the parables to us. I mean, we're in connection with him. Did you see the multitude of people that we had to turn away? Did you see those with demons bow down? They're bragging on him. I'm paraphrasing, putting some in here. I believe they're just bragging on Jesus. My goodness, what he has done. What he has performed, what he has overcome. I mean, I'm just blown away at all the miracles we've just seen, what he's capable of doing. And when they had sent the multitude away to put him in the ship, even as it was, and then there's something else here. It says, and then were also with him other little ships. So evidently, there's some other little ships out here that they seen the disciples get in this ship and they put Jesus in this ship. And they said, wherever he's going, we're going. Wherever these disciples go, I mean, man, can you imagine? Those little ships said, man, what lucky people. They got to ride in the boat with Jesus. They get to walk alongside of him. They got to be super Christians. You know, to be able to get in the boat with Jesus. There are other little ships with them. They're tagging along. They're watching from a distance. They're seeing what's taking place. They've overheard maybe that Jesus said, let's go to the other side. So you know what they're going to do? They're going to go to the other side. It wasn't to worship Jesus. It was to see what would become of Jesus, to see what was the next miracle that might take place. It was curiosity that was what was drawing them in this direction. So we got other little ships watching what the big boat's doing. We got other little ships watching, paying attention to what's going on inside of Jesus' boat. And as they're going, it says, and as the little ships are there, it says, there arose a great storm of wind, and waves beat upon the ship, or into the ship, so that it was now full. I don't know about you, but if I'm in a storm in a boat and the waves get so rough that my ship is now full, I'd probably be a nervous wreck too. But they're with Jesus. They're with the one who had just performed all these miracles. Isn't it amazing that Jesus could sleep in the storm? Isn't it amazing that you see on TV all the time, and nobody's ever done it to me, I hope it never happened, but if somebody's asleep and somebody takes some water and they splash it on them and they wake up, water is in the boat and the boat's full, yet Jesus still asleep in the midst of a storm. There's waves of rocking. I've been telling you, it's getting rough out there, but Jesus still asleep because he can sleep in a storm. Jesus knew what they were going to face as they went to the other side, but it didn't scare him. It didn't trouble him or bother him to the point to where he could not doze off to sleep. When we get overwhelmed with something, what's one thing that we'll start to lack? Sleep. We'll worry ourselves to death over whatever is getting ready to take place, but not Jesus. He went, they put him in the back of the boat, put his head on a pillow. He's still fast asleep. The boat's now full. He's in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. And they awake. And they say unto him, Master, carest not that we perish? Let me back up a little bit. I'm getting ahead of myself. Every miracle that we've seen Jesus do up to this point is a physical or a spiritual miracle that's took place. So they have seen him heal. They've seen him cast out devils. They've seen him touch physically the body of people, and it's amazing to them. They had no clue that this man Jesus could handle a storm, could change the weather, could stop the sun and the dial in the Old Testament and back up time. They had no clue that he could speak and calm the storm. So they knew that he could fix they might have thought to themselves, now listen, guys, if we drowned, he can bring us back to life because that's physical. But I don't know about this storm that I'm going through. I think sometimes that we get consumed and we get to thinking about that we're going through something that nobody else is going to go through. I wonder sometimes if we think, well, you know, nobody else on earth has ever dealt with what I'm dealing with right now. And when we do that, the devil will come by and he'll try to disguise and deceive us to the point to where that we'll get to thinking, well, if nobody else has ever been through it, then God can't handle that. So we're just going to have to go through it on your own. Those disciples, as they're inside that boat, they're rocking, they're rowing, they have completely lost the train of thought of what they just left. That's in the past. That's a memory. That's not what they're looking at in the future. They're grabbing for the sides of the boat. They're grabbing for each other. They're doing everything in their power to keep that boat afloat. But then the boat got full. When the boat got full, there ain't but one thing that's getting ready to take place. The boat's going down. Then they run to Jesus. I wonder if at first they didn't run back there. Wake up, Jesus, we're getting ready to go down. And then another says, but wake up. Jesus, do you not care that we're getting ready to perish? We're getting ready to go under. And I believe Jesus was just in the back of the boat just waiting on the call of his disciples to come to him and ask for help. Is that not the key to it? Because he says, well, where's your faith? Where's your faith at? He's in the hinder part of the boat. He's there asleep. He knows what's taking place. I can't imagine the roller coaster that he was sleeping through. Them men were screaming. They were hollering at each other. Somebody bring it about this way, bring it about that way. And I don't know ship talk, but I can just imagine how one of them wanted to turn it this way, another one turn it this way. Well, they all, some of them had experience in the water before, and you know that experience that they'd had, boy, they're trusting him. Well, Peter, what do we do now? I ain't got a clue. Never had my boat full before. They go back and they ask Jesus, Jesus, careth not that we perish. And you know what's amazing, Eric? If you come and wake me up in that sound of sleep, it's going to take me just a minute to come to my senses. Especially if you throw water in my face. I'm going to be madder than a bull. But it's going to take me a minute to get my bearings in order. I'm going to have to wake up and realize what's going on around me. But Jesus knew what was getting ready to take place. Jesus cares not that we perish, and Jesus gets up. Jesus gets up in the midst of that storm and he speaks to it. The storm that the disciples thought he would have no power over, the storm that they're going through, that he can heal physically and he can do mental things, but this is earthly things. This is above and beyond the flesh. What does he do? He speaks, and it said all of a sudden there's a great calm. There's been times in my walk that I've been overwhelmed. Been times when I thought that, God, you can't bring me through this one, because my faith would get weak. But then I finally get to the point to where I realize that there is no hope. I can hang on to the boat. I can hang on to somebody. Hang on to authority, hang on to pride, hang on to this, hang on to that. And then I finally get to that breaking point to when I say, but Jesus, I need your help. So they didn't come back to Jesus in a sarcastic way. They come back to Jesus broken. Because at this point, the boat's going down. They're in the midst in a terrible storm. If the boat goes under, it's a good chance they're all going to die in the midst of this storm. They came to Jesus broken, realizing that if you can't help, nobody can. Jesus steps up. Peace calms the storm. Said there was a great calm. Not just a little calm. All of a sudden, I don't know about you, but if you throw a rock in the water, that ripple just keeps ripple, 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 till finally it'll disappear. When Jesus spoke peace, there was an instant calm. There was no ripple. It was a piece of glass out there on that water. And those disciples, they're standing there in amazement. Oh, there's a whole other message there. Those disciples are standing there in amazement. Those little ships, They're standing there in amazement. They say, what manner of man? What manner of man is this that he can even speak to the sea and calm it? He can speak to a storm and put it to a stop. I knew that he could heal. I knew that he could do physical things, but what manner of man would be able to speak and stop the ocean and the current that's taking place in it? I can't help but to think that probably one of them disciples thought, that's the man in the boat with us. Do you realize that if you're a child of God, you're a born-again child of God, you have your name written down in the book of life. Jesus is your advocate. He pleads on our behalf. I'm his and he's mine. Nobody can take that away from me. I can't run from it. I can't hide from it. I'm his. He's the one that made the blind to see and the lame to walk. He's the one that touched the woman with the issue of blood. He's the one that cast all them demons in the swine. They run off the cliff. He's the one that speaks to a storm, speaks to the ocean, and it stops dead still. You realize that if you're a born-again child of God, he's in the boat with you. And there is nothing that you can go through that he's not right there alongside you, walking through the midst of it. You may feel like that, man, he must be in the back of the boat asleep. He's forgot about me. I don't understand. How can I go through any more than I'm going through? But he's just waiting on you. Just as these disciples, he's just waiting on you to come to him broken. I need you, Lord. Greatest times in my Christian walk, other than getting saved, is the time that I come to him broken and said, I need you. And even though I'm in the midst of some storm, some trial, no matter what it is, and all of a sudden he comes by and just speaks peace. And your anxiety's through the roof, you're overwhelmed, and he speaks to us, and all of a sudden just things just calm down. The situation didn't change. There's still anxiety, still trouble, still trials. Oh, he's going to fix it, and he helps us to get through it. But right then, peace overcomes us. Why is it? Because I come to him. Because I ask. The Bible says you have not. Why? Because you ask not. Those little, I'll try not to preach this one, but those little ships watching around the outside, they just wanted to see what was going to happen. All of a sudden, they see the storm is ceased. All of a sudden, their faith is starting to grow in that man Jesus. Why? Because they seen what he done. They seen, no doubt, if they were close, they heard those disciples bickering back and forth. They seen how that they were fussing and quarreling and trying to figure out what they're going to do and what they were going to hang on to. And maybe they'd already lightened the load, just like Paul told them to, and they throwed everything overboard. I don't know. They were watching. And as they watched, they seen the disciples turned to Jesus. Jesus turned the storm into a piece of glass. I wonder when they got to the other side, they didn't have a different outlook on the man Jesus. Not only could he heal, but he could control the universe. And he's the man that's in the boat with you. We just need not forget that. As we stand to our feet this morning, this afternoon, through some troubles and some trials and things. I don't know your heart, but God does. And maybe you feel like that you have just been left to the point that he's went to sleep. What happened? Where did he go? He's still there. He desires. He does. He desires us to worship him. He desires us to call upon him. Come to him broken. Call upon him. Derrick, one of the greatest joys in life is doing things for our children when they come with a sincere heart and have a need. And you just get to do it for them. You have the power and the means to be able to do it. I'm not talking about handling $1 million. Maybe it's a prayer that we need to pray, or show them a piece of scripture that'll give them some help, some encouragement. Whatever it might be, there's just something that I just love about when my children need me and I can do something. Don't you know that God feels the same way? When you come to him with a sincere need, I believe it's a joy. It's a joy for him to be able to help us if we just come the right way. God's touched your heart, as they say.
You don't have to know how to pray. All you have to know how to say Jesus. Oh, Jesus. In a shouted voice or a whispered tone in a crowded room, when you're all alone, just say Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Jesus. Oh, how I love the name of Jesus. Every day he's the same. Jesus, he's a lover of my soul. Oh, Jesus, there's power in the name of Jesus. My life forever changed by Jesus. He's my Savior and my Lord. You don't have to know how to pray. All you have to know is how to say Jesus. Oh, Jesus. In a shouted voice or a whispered tone in a crowded room, when you're all alone, just say Jesus. Oh, Jesus, oh, how I love the name of Jesus. Every day he's the same, Jesus. He's a lover of my soul. Oh, Jesus, there's power in the name of Jesus. My life forever changed by Jesus. He's my Savior and my Lord. Jesus, He's my Savior and my Lord.
Stuff when Derrick was preaching, I was wanting to help him. Oh, that's good. That's good. I love it. My little dog, when that warning goes off on the television, you know that. You know what? Storm warning. How many of you know? She knows what's happening. She immediately crawls under me and starts trembling. Don't wait for the boat to get full before she goes to her master. That was a good word. That'll help you. That'll help us. That'll get us through the next time.
We need to keep it in our field.
Amen. Fellowship, love on one another, you'll be at liberty to go.